$130 silver sounds pretty silly at current metal prices, but that's where I'm expecting silver is going to go over the next rally. And time will only tell whether I'm right or wrong.
Start investing in gold and silver at sdbullion.com today and join over 35,000 precious metals investors who have made the switch to the lowest gold and silver prices in the industry. SD Bullion recently claimed a spot on the prestigious Inc. 500, making them one of the fastest-growing bullion companies in the United States. With low bullion prices and over-the-top customer service, SD Bullion is setting the standard for precious metals transactions. Visit www.sdbullion.com today. Start saving on every precious metals purchase you make.
The independent media is under attack. The Telegraph is reporting that Google is changing its search results to promote what it considers to be reputable news sources and government websites and punish those deemed low quality. Finance and Liberty and many other independent news YouTube channels are experiencing reduced revenue. Finance and Liberty earnings and views from the first quarter of 2017 were down nearly 50% compared to 1 year ago. My goal is to continue running my independent media outlet and create even more quality content. So I've created a Patreon account. If you'd like to become a supporter, simply make a pledge. Once we reach our $2,000 a month goal, I will create an exclusive podcast featuring one of you. Yes, I will be interviewing one Patreon subscriber per month and let them tell their own story of how they woke up to the reality of our fraudulent financial system and the importance of owning sound money. I want to build a community of like-minded individuals. If you can make a monetary pledge to help Finance and Liberty, then awesome. Go to patreon.com/financeandliberty and pledge as little as $1 per month. I understand that not everyone can pay for extra content, and I want to make the community open to everyone. So I will be sending out the special monthly podcasts in the Finance and Liberty free newsletter as well. So if you don't have any funds to pledge, simply go to financeandliberty.com or click here to sign up for the Finance and Liberty newsletter.
Hey everyone, this is Elijah Johnson with financeandliberty.com.
And with us today is Keith Neumeyer, the president and CEO of First Majestic Silver. Keith, thank you so much for joining us today.
Well, thanks, Elijah. Nice chatting with you as well.
All right. Now, I'd first like to discuss precious metal manipulation, especially silver manipulation, because you have actually worked to fight against this. Now, before we talk a little bit about the specifics here, did you want to share your perspective on how the silver price is manipulated?
It's done in many, many ways, obviously, but a lot of it's through high frequency trading. Some is actually done very meaningfully. As some of the disclosure that's come out of Barclays, quite nicely points out, whereby the traders are actually in communication via text messaging, doing exactly the same thing together in a designed fashion to move the price in one direction or the other. And when traders are communicating in that way on a collective basis to move a market to achieve an objective to make a trade for profit, that's manipulation as far as I'm concerned. And there's a lot of evidence out there that this is occurring. And also, spoof trading is quite an interesting phenomenon, and it's done through either direct trading or also through computer systems, whereby a fake order, whether it's a buy order or a sell order, gets put into the market, and it would be a very sizable order, and it's designed to either excite or scare a particular market, and it forces traders who are watching the bid and asks of any type of vehicle that's being traded, in this case gold and silver, to actually start to buy or sell depending on what the spoof orders look like at the time. And when the spoof orders actually start to have an effect on the market, these orders disappear quite mysteriously, and that is very illegal, but it happens on a very, very regular basis.
Now, you're actually one of the only silver producers to actually take up a stand against the manipulation. Can you tell us how you're doing that?
Well, vocally, doing interviews like this, obviously, is helpful to get the message out there to let people know these things are happening. Because the only way that these things will end is if people speak up and talk about it. And that's what I try to do as much as I can, you know, without, you know, sounding crazy, you know, because often, you know, people that talk about manipulation, you know, get put in the crazy camp. And I can tell you, quite frankly, I'm not crazy. I've worked for the banks and I used to work on the floor of the stock exchange, and I'm very familiar with trading. I've got a unique knowledge of how trading actually occurs and what traders do and how they execute orders, and I've been part of it. I did it myself for the banks that I used to trade for. So there's not the very few, and I actually don't know of any, quite frankly, CEOs of mining companies that have my background. You know, most mining executives, you know, have geology or engineering background, and they generally don't get involved in you know, the trading of the metals. They quite all, it's just not their forte. It's not their expertise.
It is curious though that other silver producers haven't spoken out against the manipulation, because it seems like they're one of the big players that are really impacted by it, aren't they?
Well, of course. That's one of the reasons why, you know, I tend to be vocal about it, because I'm trying to, you know, not only pass the message on to investors who care about these, you know, such things, but also to the mining industry itself, because, you know, I know mining executives often listen to some of the things I say, and not that I'm, you know, influencing them by any stretch of the imagination. I wish my words would influence them more, but unfortunately it doesn't, you know, because as I said, you know, previously, that, you know, it's just not, you know, their forte. You know, it's my background is very much a financial background and a trading background. And you know, I guess that's probably why, you know, I'm one that is most outspoken about what's happening in the manipulation of gold and silver, because I quite honestly understand it better than most.
Now, I was recently listening to an interview you did a while back on Kitco News, and you were talking about the Deutsche Bank lawsuit. You know, we've talked a lot on the show about the Deutsche Bank lawsuit and how Deutsche Bank had to settle on claims that they were manipulating the prices of gold and silver. Now, you're saying that actually Deutsche Bank is really a small player in the manipulation, and that other banks are much larger players.
Yeah, I think that's very true. And, you know, of course, you know, we don't have access to their trading records. And quite honestly, that's a bit of a guess on my part. But, you know, we do trading ourselves. You know, we're a big producer of silver and gold, of course. And so we use the banks as part of, to facilitate the sale of our metal. You know, we have no choice but to use the banks. It's the way the system works. So I know who the big players are out there. And I think it's pretty well known throughout the industry that, you know, the top three are Scotia and HSBC and UBS.
So if these banks weren't manipulating the price, where do you think silver would be now?
Well, we're mining 9-to-1. So what that means is for every 1 ounce of gold on a worldwide basis, all the mining activity taking place, for every 1 ounce of gold taken out of the ground, we're taking 9 ounces of silver out of the ground. That's a shocking statistic, you know, when you're trading at 70-to-1. So, you know, how does a metal trade at 70-to-1 and then have almost a year's worth of supply short in the marketplace and trade, and then 70-to-1 when we're mining 9-to-1. So you ask me where the price should be, it should be 9-to-1, which is, you know, $140 silver. I've said it 100 times and I'll keep saying it, and time will only tell if I'm right, but quite honestly, that's where the metal should be.
Now, what is the motive behind manipulating the price? Is it just to, you know, make money for the banks, or is it, I've heard also the idea that precious metals are manipulated to make the dollar look stronger. What is your perspective?
Well, you're talking more probably on gold than silver. You know, the central banks don't own any silver. You know, the central banks own gold. So, you know, you could argue, and I know a lot of pundits out there argue the fact that, you know, it's in the best interest of the central banks to suppress the gold price because it makes their currencies, you know, look stronger. And, you know, I guess there's some validity to that. But, you know, in the case of silver, it's a, you know, quite a different animal. You know, you're you know, this is an industrial metal. Silver is a very much a strategic metal, you know, for everything that we do as a human being currently in this day and age, we require silver, you know, from the, you know, you're sleeping in your home is operating because of silver. You know, you get to work in the morning, you know, via, you know, some kind of motorized vehicle, which is requires silver. You're on your iPhone and your computer all day long, which requires silver. You know, a lot of energy is being produced through solar panels and wind energy. You know, Tesla cars, electric cars, you know, fuel cell cars of the future, robotics, you know, clean energy as we get off oil and gas, which has obviously started. You know, we're probably in a 30-year phase of changing the way we produce energy, which is all very exciting for the consumption of silver. So, you know, we have a supply deficit in 2016, and you know, we're the miners are, you know, producing about 800 million ounces of silver a year. We're consuming about 1.1 billion ounces of silver a year. So, you know, I think that the fundamentals are obviously extremely good for the metal, and you know, but it's simply just not showing up in the price yet. But I think it will. And you know, if you're, you know, Toyota, and you all of a sudden, you know, can't produce an electric car, you're Sony, you can't produce a television, you know, this is going to get out, and it'll will hit mainstream. And once that occurs, prices will change. But, you know, your question was what, you know, what's the motivation to keep the price down? So, you know, if you're, you know, let's say you're, you know, one of the banks, I'm not going to name a bank, it's not really relevant which bank it is, but, you know, you're Sony, and you need your 50 million ounces of silver or whatever number you need for 2017 to produce your televisions, and you do a deal with the bank, and then the bank guarantees you the delivery of those 50 million ounces at whatever port they agree to deliver it to. So all of a sudden, you as Sony can produce all your televisions that you need to produce for 2017, and you've got a fixed price for that silver. So now all of a sudden, the bank who's now done the contract to supply Sony with that silver has a short position and is required to go out and buy the silver from the miners in order to supply Sony. So that's your short position. Now, is it, you know, all of a sudden silver's, you know, they do that short sale at $18, all of a sudden silver's $25, all of a sudden that short position starts to cost the bank more money, right? And they start to lose their margin to the sale that they've just done previously to the commercial end user. So there is definitely an interest among the banks who make that transaction to keep the price suppressed.
Now, I'd like to move on here to viewers' questions. The first viewer's question has to do with the possibility of nationalization of mines. Do you see the possibility of mines being nationalized and also their assets in the ground being nationalized when their value skyrockets?
Well, I've never heard of that. You know, there's definitely countries in the world that I wouldn't do business in. You know, countries like, you know, Venezuela or China or Russia. You know, they're you know, a lot of the stands, you know, Kyrgyzstan and Kazakhstan. You know, there's several areas around the world that I think are just too risky, you know, on a political side, whereby, you know, you could potentially have your asset taken away. You know, where First Majestic does business in Mexico, I think the chances of that happening are virtually nil. Where First Mining owns their projects in Nevada and Ontario, Quebec, Newfoundland, as well as Mexico. I think in those jurisdictions that would be extremely unlikely, virtually nil again. So it really depends on the project. It really depends on where the asset's located, I think.
All right, moving on here to the next viewer's question from Gary. He's wanting to know, in what ways can we help assist miners to fight against the precious metal manipulation?
Well, I guess there's two things that come to mind. Well, one would be to buy physical metal. So you know, take the metal off the market and put it away somewhere. And you know, I do my fair share. I buy physical gold and silver every single year, and I've been doing that for quite some time and likely will continue to do that. The other thing is just to be vocal about it. You know, talk about it among, you know, your associates and maybe write letters to the CFTC. You know, they've now, you know, it's quite interesting. Ted Butler, just one of his pieces recently, about 2 weeks ago, wrote quite an interesting article about this fellow that used to work for Deutsche Bank, who's now become the hired gun for the CFTC to help them uncover the manipulation that's been going on over the last several years among the other banks other than Deutsche Bank. And they actually news released the fact that they've hired this individual, which is quite astounding. So, you know, the CFTC is all of a sudden now taking this whole thing seriously. So, you know, I think if people out there were, you know, continually write letters to the CFTC and just remain vocal, I think eventually, you know, the manipulation will end. And quite honestly, you know, I believe it's ending anyways. You know, the banks are just getting tired of getting fined. You know, we all know that the big fines that have been levied against the banks over the last several years on manipulating all kinds of different markets, and not just gold and silver, but a variety of different markets. And, you know, these billion-dollar fines that they're getting from governments on seemingly on a regular basis, you know, it would cost the banks, you know, a lot of money. And it's not only embarrassing for them that these traders are doing these things, you know, but it's costing them real dollars. And I think their shareholders are probably getting tired of the banks doing these things as well. So I think the whole process is unwinding itself, but I'm still going to remain vocal until I see, you know, it end. And I think, but I think it will end naturally on its own, just because the regulators and shareholders getting involved.
Now, some people, when they, you know, hear about the manipulation of precious metal prices, it kind of makes them not want to, you know, get into the system at all, or they just want to hold physical precious metals, not get into stocks or anything like that. This viewer seems to be one of those viewers. He's wanting to know, I'm extremely interested in First Majestic, Silver One, etc. I opened an account with Schwab last year, but never purchased First Majestic stock, only because of the naked shorting and other market shenanigans. I have a fear of being fleeced while attempting to conduct fair business transactions. How can I purchase, own, hold, and redeem First Majestic stock as a true and secure business transaction?
Well, that's a good question, and it's a concern of mine as well. You know, we have an industry that is an extremely important industry to the human population. Without mining, everything that we do as a human race just simply wouldn't happen. And copper, lead, zinc, gold, silver. You know, gold less so, but silver and all these metals that we need to produce all the products that we use on a regular basis. They're critical to what we do on a daily basis. And I think sometimes the mining sector, you know, is forgotten because it's kind of, no one really thinks about it because there's not a mine in the middle of the city. You know, these mines are way out in the middle of nowhere, and people generally don't think about, you know, hopping in their car and what's actually making their car run. But, mining is not only an important business, but in a lot of cases, mining companies are actually good companies. You know, they're good stewards, they're serious businesses, but they're risky as well. And the risk comes from the fact that the metal is so volatile, and the mining sector is cyclical. I believe that we're going back into a bull market. I could be wrong, quite frankly, but my view is that we're going back into a bull market. We had a bull market that went from 2002 to 2012, a 10-year bull market, and I built First Majestic during that period of time into the second largest silver producer in Mexico, with 6 producing mines, and we produced about 18 million ounces of silver equivalent this year, and we're a pretty big company of 4,000 employees and so on and so forth. So we're profitable, making money. But if the silver price is dropping, unfortunately our share price is going to drop, and that's just a fact of the matter. So you or your listeners, the investors out there that are listening to this interview, have to be very well aware of that. So if you unfortunately bought the stock last summer, where the stock went from, around the $4 or $5 range from January 2016, and it went all the way up to 25 Canadian, $20 US. And if you bought it in July of 2016 and you still own it today, well, you're down money, unfortunately. And there's nothing we can do about that. But the silver price went from 1330 in January, which was extremely low, obviously, and it went all the way up to almost $21 by July, August, and the stock, you know, went up 500%. So, you know, these are the kinds of moves that you can get in a good mining stock. But the reverse can occur as well. If you're, as I said, if you're the unlucky person that bought it at the high and silver went from 21 approximately down back down to 16 and the stock goes cut in half, you know, you're not a very happy shareholder. But, you know, I can tell you as the CEO of First Majestic that, you know, we're a serious group and we've got a great company. And I'm a huge believer in the future of the metal and the future of First Majestic. And if you buy the stock at the right time before a big move in the silver price, you can do extremely well on the stock. And I just happen to think that over the next 3 to 5 years, we're going back into a major bull cycle again. And last time, you know, not that history always repeats itself, but when I put First Majestic together, silver was $5, and I predicted it would hit 50, which it did. It took 10 years, but it hit $50. And this time around, let's say the low, it was 13 approximately, and it goes again 10 times, you know, five times 10 was 50. So $13 times 10 is $130. And, you know, $130 silver sounds pretty silly at current metal prices, but that's where I'm expecting silver is going to go over the next rally. Time will only tell whether I'm right or wrong.
All right. Well, Keith Newmar, thank you so much for joining us today. Before we let you go, I was just wondering, so you're saying long-term target, maybe, you know, 130, somewhere around there. Where do you see silver going the rest of this year?
You know, I think that it's consolidating right now. You know, I think that, this mid-16 level, will hold. If you go back, and look at, this time of year, generally speaking, May, June, July are the weakest times for the metal price. And, 2016 was quite a different year. So don't use 2016 as an example because it simply was completely opposite 2016. But virtually every other year, it's always the weak part of the cycle. And the metals, you generally turn around in August, September, and then we generally have a relatively strong end to a year and beginning of the next year, for the metals. So I'm expecting the same type of thing to happen this year, and I would expect to see $20 to $21 silver by the end of 2017.
Before we let you go, did you want to share with the viewers any last thoughts you had and where they can find you online?
Well, I've got a Twitter account, just Keith_Neumeyer, N-E-U-M-E-Y-E-R. And I don't do a heck of a lot of tweets, but every once in a while I'll send something out that's, interesting. And of course, First Majestic's website at firstmajestic.com and First Mining Finance's website, firstminingfinance.com. There's lots of information on both of those companies and welcome anyone to look at that. But if there's additional information that you need about the company, please feel free to call either Todd Anthony, who's VP of Investor Relations at First Majestic. He's a great guy to talk to and a wealth of information. And Derek Iwanaka, who's the VP of Investor Relations at First Mining Finance, is also available to answer any questions. And there's quite an interesting drill program going on. Goldlund, which is First Mining's project, and lots of news coming out on that company over the balance of this year. Lots of drill results, which I'm excited about. Quite excited about.
Really appreciate the time. Thank you so much.
Yeah, nice chatting.
This video was brought to you in part by ReluctantPreppers.com, helping you be aware and prepared. Click here to watch one of Reluctant Preppers' latest interviews.